Amen. Well, good morning. It's good to see you this morning. We're glad that you're here and look forward to what God has in store for us this morning as we gather together to worship and celebrate Him. I hope this morning that as you have come in to worship and celebrate your Lord and Savior, that you come with expectation, because God has big plans for you. But He's waiting for you and your expectations of those plans. And so we gather together here today, anticipating God doing some things among us and in us and through us and showing us what He has for us. And I pray that today we will be able to see at least one item for ourselves that God is trying to show us. Every Sunday we gather together here to worship Him. We're here to honor Him, to glorify Him, to lift His name on high. But at the same time, He comes here wanting to impact each one of us. And there shouldn't be a Sunday that we come into God's presence. Actually, there shouldn't be any day that we come into God's presence that we don't walk away changed, because we serve an awesome and amazing God. And so I encourage you this morning to consider even now what God may be wanting to do in your life today. When you came in, you should have been given a bulletin, and inside that bulletin are announcements, upcoming activities that you'll want to be aware of, as well as an order of service for this morning. You'll want to check those announcements out. There is a connection card attached to that bulletin, and if you would, take a minute, fill that card out, let us know you're here, especially if you're a guest. If you'd fill that card out and just place it in the offering plate as your offering this morning, we would be grateful. On the back of that card, there is a place for prayer requests. If there's anything going on in your life, your family's life, that we can be praying about, please share that with us. This evening during our evening service, which we have in the chapel, two buildings over, we start at 6 o'clock. We will begin that service by taking every single one of these prayer requests that is turned in today, and someone will be praying specifically over your request. So we encourage you to share that with us and let us know what we can be praying about, because we want to see God doing amazing things in and through the family of God. And He wants to do that in your life. So if you'd share that with us, we would be grateful. And then just place that connection card in the offering plate a little bit later in the service. That's a time when our members give their tithes and offerings for the support of the ministries here at First Baptist. And it is exciting to see what God is doing among us. Let me open us with a word of prayer, and then we're going to worship and praise together. Father God, we just come before You now, and we thank You for the privilege of worship and the opportunity to gather together. Lord, You have brought us together today not just for our own benefit, but for the benefit of others as well. We have joined corporately here this morning that we might honor and glorify You, that we might lift Your name on high. So we thank You, Lord, for each and every one here. We thank You for what You're desiring to do in their life and what You're desiring to do in our own. And we pray for wisdom and discernment as we hear Your word proclaimed. We pray that You would show us through the words of these songs that we lift to You, through our encounter with one another, what it is You desire to do this day in our lives. So, Lord, have Your way with us. Receive the worship of Your people as a blessing to You, Lord. May we be found faithful in our worship now. We ask all these things in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. Mike?
Would you stand with me, please? And would you turn to those around you and shake a hand this morning? Come into His presence with thanksgiving in your heart, and give Him praise, and give Him praise. Come into His presence with thanksgiving in your heart, your voice is raised, your voice is raised. Give glory. the name above all names. Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart and give him praise, and give him praise. Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart, your voice is raised, your voice is raised. Says, sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise his name. Psalm 100 says, shout for joy to the Lord. Let's sing this song, shout to the Lord.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower, Shout to the Lord, all the earth let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the is a strong and mighty power. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the name sing louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Jesus, strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your.
Everything that we have, Lord, we give you thanks. Father, now, out of obedience to you, Father, we return to you a portion of what you've given to us. We pray your blessings on these tithes and offerings, Father. We pray that that through these gifts, your name is spread throughout this world. In Christ Jesus, that we pray.
I invite you to sing along with me. This is Chris Tomlin's version of Jesus Loves Me.
I was lost, I was in chains, the world had a hold of me. My heart was a stone, I was covered in shame when he came for me. I couldn't run, couldn't run from his presence.
Thank you so much that you love us beyond our comprehension, Father. We thank you that that you're for us. You love us with a love that's everlasting. We thank you for that love, and thank you that you show it to us each and every day. We pray this morning, Father, that you can, through your power, Holy Spirit, Father, that you would open our eyes, open our hearts to hear what the message is from our pastor this morning. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Mike. Well, as we have considered in our study of the provisions of God, looking at what provisions he has given us for a successful society, it is important for us to consider and look to the rights recognized for such a society. For by definition, a civilization or a civil society must have certain expectations put forth of the rights of the individuals in order to assure civil action by all. You know, the idea that we are free, I think I think to a certain extent we have taken that a little too far. Hear me out. I'm free to do a lot of things, but I also have the consequences of the choices that I make. And when we talk about a society, when we talk about a civilized society, we have got to have a certain level of expectation on each other, not just upon ourselves. You know, as part of a civil society, I expect you to respect my rights just as you should expect me to respect your rights. Otherwise, it doesn't work. It's not a society of one. And so as we continue our focus on looking at the provisions that God has given for a successful society, we want to talk about some of these ideas of rights this morning. And when we consider what God has entrusted to us, we should begin with that which God Himself would hold most dear. What is it that you have that God would consider most dear? Well, I'd like you to open your Bibles to the very front, Genesis chapter 1 to verse 26, and let's see what God considers the crown of all He created. Genesis 1, 26, follow along as I read, it says, "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth.' God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created them." God's crowning moment of His creation. You and I. Now, before I go on, turn a couple pages to Genesis chapter 9. Because I want to make sure we catch God's thoughts here, not ours. You know, I can take those two verses out of Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27 that we just read, and I can feel pretty good about that. I mean, after all, I am part of God's crown of all creation. And He put me, He put you, us, in charge of all of His creation. We must be pretty important, aren't we? But let's not get too carried away, because it's God who established this. But look at chapter 9, verse 6. It says, "Whoever sheds man's blood, by man his blood shall be shed. For in the image of God, He made him." He made man. The reason I wanted to grab that passage is because I wanted you to see how important this idea is. The first right that you and I as individuals should have in any civilized society, everyone has the right to life. A right to life. It is precious in the eyes of God, given by Him, crafted in His image. We must realize that God has given life to everyone who has it. And unless God has ordained it to be taken away, no man has the right to do so. And yet we read in chapter 9 that there is a time. Why should a man's life be taken from him? Well, God says one of the main reasons is because He has taken something that is precious, valuable, and a crown of His creation, and destroyed it. When a man takes another man's life. Now, I know I may not be real popular with this thought, And it's really not my thought. But I believe what Genesis 9:6 says is there's an idea of capital punishment. But I'm not interested in that aspect of it this morning. What I want you to catch is how important this is to God. How important the idea of life is to God. I do not find in Scripture a discussion of the quality of life being determined or being a determining factor of its worth. If I'm wrong, please come and correct me sometime. Not right now. But I don't find where it says in Scripture that your quality of life is a determination of whether your life is of value or not. God gave it. That's the value. I do not see a discussion of the independent ability to live being a qualification of the right of life either. After all, we've got some over in the nursery. We've got a couple in here. Little tiny lives. And we see in those faces, we see in those eyes, we see in the shape of that nose a little bit of mom or a little bit of dad or maybe a grandparent represented in there. But that little tiny life, so precious, so endearing to our hearts, that's able to do absolutely nothing for itself except cry and make a mess in its diaper. What else can it do? Lay there and sleep? So, would we say the value of that life is less because it is not able to take care of itself, to sustain itself? No, we don't find that justification anywhere in Scripture. God has given cause for life to be taken, as we read in chapter 9. For the price of taking another's life without justification, by God's punishment of loss of life. That too reinforces the value that God places on life itself. We have a right to life. As we consider society, we need to focus on our interaction with each other. That's what society is it not? How do we interact with one another? How do we get along? How do we make sure that we function well? And when we look to God and what's important to Him, I think one of the areas that we need to consider is that God gave 10 commandments to start the people of God off on their civilization, on their society. In those first 4 commandments, we see that they deal with a relationship with God. And that is of utmost importance for every single individual. But we're not talking this morning about specifically our relationship with God, but our idea of what God has given us for a society. So I'm going to set those 4 aside for right now. Not that they're not important, but that's not our focus this morning. 2 more of the commandments deal with an eternal relationship with ourselves. About how, you know, you get to the last one and it says, thou shalt not, if you're reading your King James, thou shalt not covet your neighbor's, and then it lists all these things out. You know, I want you to recognize, though we're not going to go there this morning, that's an internal relationship that you're dealing with. That really has very little to do with your neighbor. It has to do with your heart. Also, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy is in your heart and in your relationship with God and honoring your mother and father. That's what you need to do from within. It's about a relationship within. The remaining 4 deal with relating to one another, and that's what I want to add in here this morning because evidently it was pretty important. God carved it out in 2 stone tablets for the children of Israel to establish their civilization, how they would relate to one another and what is important. And it reveals the rights that God believes that He has given to each and every one of us. So number 6. What is it? They're singing over here. They're trying to get there. What? Thank you. Do not murder. Number 6 is do not murder. This again restates the right that every person has to live, lest God determine otherwise. Life is a right. Convenience should never trump life. Let me just say that though many people in our society have opposing views on this subject, God does not. A beating heart, a lifeblood flowing through the body, the growth, the ability to move. Life is precious, and anyone who thinks that as long as you have not taken your first breath on your own, you do not have a right to life unless the woman carrying you decides to give it to you, is adamantly in direct conflict with God. Now, I know that's not a popular thing to say in our society today. But we're not here to gain popularity. I'm here to speak the truth. Truth of the matter is, in the time since we began this worship service, using the statistics from 2009, approximately 105 lives were aborted here in the United States that were reported. In that same time, 3,670 lives, 75 lives were terminated around the world that would be reported. Just since we began worship. Now, some of them will give justification that the baby's life was not of any quality. That they may not have lived had they been born. But I would say for a high percentage, and especially, forgive me, but in the United States, a high percentage is simply out of convenience. It is an act of convenience. It is inconvenient for me to have to take care of this child. And so there's an answer. That's what our society has given for an answer. And anybody who thinks that way, that that is okay, is in adamant conflict with God. Do you know that we now have people who are willing to allow this practice to continue up to the time of birth? Living in our society, living among us, that they are willing to allow this procedure to take place right up to the time of birth, if the mother so chooses that she doesn't want to have to deal with this new life. I hope you recognize how precious God feels life is, and that it is a right. That no one individual should be able to have the determination of whether or not your life is worth living. And please understand this. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but you've got to realize how we work. Because as soon as you set one line as to where it's okay for one person to have the right to decide in a certain situation that another person's life is not worth living and they have the right to terminate that. As soon as you set one line, you now open up the channel for that line to continually to be moved. You know, let me say it this way. When I played Little League Baseball, you got 4 balls and you walked. You got 3 strikes and you were out. End of discussion. There wasn't a time where you could stand up there and get 30 pitches to swing at, and you could swing at all of them because we wanted everybody to get a hit. And yet each time you make a little concession to make someone feel a little bit better, every time one little line is drawn, it opens the door for giant movement, whether it be in a game or whether it be in life. And the fact that our society decided they had the right to determine what life is and what the value of life is, I hope you realize how that has accentuated itself. No longer do we just deal with the beginning of life and whether it's convenient or not to determine whether this child will get to be born, but now we've gone to the other end. And we've begun evaluating whether or not your life as an old individual sitting in a nursing home in a vegetative state is worth living, and we should just terminate you. Or to the point of, I've got a disease and it's uncomfortable and I don't like it, and I should have the right to just end my life, or you should have the right to do that for me. You see how the line moves when we take a right and determine that we have power over it. You have the right to life. Commandment in 7 and 8 say, do not commit adultery and do not steal. Now, why have I linked these together? Well, to get to the root of the problem. God has blessed us with the right of possession, and no one should have the right to take it from us. In fact, if you look sometime at the full chapter of Exodus in chapter 22, it deals with God's consequences when you take something that is not yours. Now, wives, let me say that I am not implying that your husband is your property. You can laugh. However, the commitment you have made to one another in marriage, and the commitment that you have made to one another before God, should not be taken away by anyone. Including each other. But to the root of these two ideas, you do have the right to property. In fact, when God placed man, when we read that passage in Genesis 1, 26 and 27, you will get a sense of God's idea here. Because he put you and I in charge of all of the rest of his creation. You are to rule over it. You are to take possession of it. You are to move throughout the world and multiply and overcome it. That's who we are. That's what we were created to be. We have a right to property. Now, I don't know if there's anybody here this morning that was not born and raised in the United States of America. But there are places around this world where you don't have the right to have anything of your own. When it comes to land, it belongs to the country. You don't get to use it. You get to live on it. And then you get to give it whatever produces from it. You get a little bit of it, and you get to give the rest to the government. And they have control of everything. See, we don't experience a lot of those things because of where we live, because of where God placed us. But he placed you here to help you understand you have a right to have things that are yours. That passage in Exodus that I was talking about, if someone else, it even talks about when someone borrows something from you, they borrow your horse and it dies, well, where does the responsibility lie? You have a right to what is yours. Now, as with every single right that God has given us, we can take those to the extreme, and we can make those what we worship rather than God if we're not careful. Commandment number 9, do not bear false witness. Let me remind you of a verse from last week when we discussed accountability. It was Deuteronomy 17:6 that says, on the evidence of 2 witnesses or 3 witnesses, he who is to die shall be put to death. He shall not be put to death on the evidence of 1 witness. Truth must be pursued. You have a right to fair judgment. Man is bent towards sin, and it is just to seek support for any statement of consequence. Every person has the right to fair judgment. I can't take one person's word about you, though we often do, don't we? I can't take one person's word about you and make a choice and a judgment upon your life. Don't do that. You remember what that's like if you think back just a little bit. Move back into this group's time period when you were a teenager. All it took was one person to say, did you hear what so-and-so said about you? And oh, it's over. Doesn't matter whether it was true. We don't even look to see if it was a lot of times when we were that age. We just take it and run with it. Sad thing is, some of us don't grow up and we continue to do that today. Some of us have an opinion of someone else, or there's been a relationship that has been broken in our lives, and it wasn't even because of an encounter between the two of us, it was because what someone else told us. That is not right. That is not the correct approach. That's not how we live in a successful society. God gave us the instructions of how to do this. He showed us how to handle this. You have a right to fair judgment. Now, along with that is you're accountable. If you do something wrong, then you should pay the price. But it's not based on just one person's testimony. We need to make sure that we get to the truth of the matter in every situation. Now, I will admit my shortcoming at this moment. There are some things that we just don't have the time and energy to get to the bottom of and the absolute truth of, and I don't know, there's so much garbage out there that I don't know that we can. But we're living in those times right now if you turn your TV on, aren't we? We have a hard time with that, finding any of that out at this point with what's going on in our society. Now, I'd like to say that these two rights of right of property and right of fair judgment, I would not say that these two rights are necessarily second and third in line after life. I would say life comes first, no doubt about that. But there's one additional consideration for us that comes from God when He sent a Savior for us, which reveals one additional right that every person is entitled to. And I'd like you to look at one more verse with me, John chapter 8, if you'd turn there very quickly. John chapter 8. Verse 31 is where we're going to start. And I want you to listen to these words. Beginning in verse 31 of John chapter 8, I'm going to read verses 31 and 32, and then we're going to drop down and read 36. Here's what it says. So Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed him, if you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And then down to verse 36. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. The last thing you have a right to is you have a right to liberty, to freedom. Now, I don't know that we fully understand all the nuances of those words, liberty and freedom. But God has given you the right to be free. God desires that all men be free. He has offered us liberty if we will accept it. He has paid the price for that liberty. And through it, we are free indeed. Through his Son, Jesus Christ, we have been made free if we choose to accept what he has done for us. Now, if we apply these rights as we have described them to society, what's that going to look like? We've talked about the right of freedom. We've talked about the right of fair judgment, of property, and of course, of life. What does that look like if we were to apply that to our society to find a successful society that God has provided all the tools for? Well, it might initially be declared this society for all to realize similar to this. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. They might then be considered in the structure and order of the society that we put together to place them so that they'll never be questioned in their authority, that these are rights that everyone in this society has. And they might be stated similar to this: we, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. It may also include statements such as, no person shall be convicted of treason unless on the testimony of two witnesses to the same overt act or confession in court. Or maybe, no, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without the due process of law. You see, whether it be on these major rights or things such as the penalty of blood only for the offender in Article 3 of the Constitution, linked with Ezekiel 18:20, or the exemption of taxes for the church, linked with Ezra 7:24, or even the idea of free enterprise and providing for your family from 1 Timothy 5:8. Our founders were seeking God's provision for a successful society, just as we have been discussing these past weeks. I urge you to consider that what has been started is what we have, as followers of Christ, should desire to sustain with everything in us. What are we willing to do to hold on to what we have been given? That's the question that we have to ask. As followers of Christ, what are we willing to do to hold on to that which we have been given? God has given us provisions for a successful society, and they have actually been implemented. The question is, what are we willing to do to keep them? What are we willing to do to hold on to what God has set in motion? Not what man has set in motion. Please understand that. It is only by man's desire to seek God's will that we have had these things established. What are we willing to do to hold on to what we've been given? Do not lose heart. Jesus has not yet returned, so we're not done with our roles in this world. He's not here yet. He hasn't come back yet. There is a time, and he is coming. And sometimes we pray diligently and we say, Lord, come quickly. Come now. But it is on his timing. The Father knows when he will return. We do not. So what do we do in the meantime? Do we just give up? Do we just say, well, Jesus is coming and it really doesn't matter? I mean, I've read the end of the story and I know how it plays out and we win in the end. So what difference does it make in the in-between times? Really? Are we willing to go to that extreme? Are we willing to give up that easily? is the hope that you have placed in Jesus that shallow that we just give up? You know, I hear it said from time to time, well, it'll all work out. It'll all work out. Tell me one example of anything in all of creation that works out all by itself. Let's just be honest about it. The tree standing in your front yard will eventually do what? It's going to die. That's non-negotiable. Now, whether it does it in your lifetime or not, you may have something to do with that. You know, you may speed it up with a chainsaw, or you may lengthen it by taking care of it and fertilizing it and watering it. You can have an impact. But folks, what I want you to understand is I don't want us to lose hope. I don't want us to look at the world and look at our own society and say, it's gone. There's no hope here. But I see a lot of people living that way right now. And when you live that way, when you make that inference that there's just no hope, then you miss the God that I worship and serve. Because there is always hope. There is always power. You know, my salvation is not just based on a decision that I made. My salvation is based on the confession and the belief that I have made. But it is also based very firmly on the power of the resurrection that happened that Sunday morning, early in the morning before dayrise, when out of that tomb came the Son of God alive. And it is by that power that I live. I cannot succumb to this idea that we just give up and there is no hope. That's not acceptable as a follower of Jesus. Because it adamantly goes against everything that Jesus came for. My hope is not in man. My hope is in God. And God gave us provisions from His Word on how to have a successful society. And I'm not willing to give up on that. And I hope you won't either. I hope you will take your relationship with God and your position as an heir to the kingdom, as an ambassador for the greatest kingdom that ever was or ever will be, I hope you will take that role seriously and live it out. Because when we begin to say, well, there's no hope, and what's the use, then we have clearly told the people who are outside of the walls of the church this morning, who don't see any hope, we have told them that there's nothing different happening in here when we act that way. See, people are watching you and I, claiming to be followers of Christ. They're watching us. And they truly want to see something different in our lives, that we have a hope that endures, that we have a security that gives us continual joy even in the midst of turmoil. Not happiness, but joy. They want to see that. They want to believe that it's possible, but they're looking at you and I. And if there's nothing different about our lives, if we're not living that out, then they're just going to say, well, there's nothing that they have to offer me. And they will die without knowing Jesus. You and I, we are different. We're meant to stick out as followers of Jesus. And here's the thing you need to recognize in this. Even the people out there who don't want to believe what you and I have chosen to believe about our relationship with God. Even those people out there expect us to live in such a way that reveals that we do believe it. They expect that of us. Are they finding it? Let's show the world what a successful society truly looks like based on a hope in the one true God and a Savior that He sent, based on the power of the resurrection. Let's show the world that type of a society in how we live together in community here. After all, we do live in Missouri, and they want you to show them. So that begins with us. What are we going to do to be a part of that type of a society? Life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. Not about a constitution, it's about a relationship with Him. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, when we look at the circumstances around us, we can easily begin to lose hope. Just like Peter when he stepped out of the boat into the waves and the storm when Jesus said, "Come." It was Peter who stepped out of that boat with confidence because Jesus had called him. And he began walking on the water, overcoming the turmoil of the storm. He began walking toward Jesus on top of it all. But Lord, it's so easy for us to succumb to the same thing that Peter did. He took his eyes off Jesus. And he looked at the circumstances that he found himself in and he began to sink. And Lord, too many of your followers right now are beginning to sink because they've taken their eyes off of you. Our hope is not in any person. Our hope is not in any elected office. Our hope is not even in a constitution, even though we believe that the writers sought your will and direction for it. That is not where our hope is. Our hope is in nothing less than Jesus' blood and His righteousness. We have the tools to be a successful society, to love one another, to treat one another with respect, to have the rights that You as Creator gave us, and to honor those not only in our own lives but in each other's lives, if we so choose. But God, just like in the garden with Adam and Eve, You gave them the ability to choose. And we still have that. Another right You gave us. We have the right to choose badly, or we have the right to choose well. Help us choose well in how we live our lives and in how we engage the society that we are a part of. And may we glorify and honor You with it all. Lord, right now I just want to lift up every single individual in this room right now and those who may be watching us. I pray, Lord, that You would help us to stop and consider where we are in relationship with You at this moment. Because there are some who are listening to my voice right now, Lord, who do not know You as Lord and Savior. They have not confessed that you are Lord. They have not received what Jesus has done on the cross for them. They have not experienced and believed in the power of the resurrection. Oh, but today is a new day. And today can be the beginning of life for them and of liberty for them. If they will just accept the gift that you have given them right now. If they would just stop and realize that there is nothing in the world that can take care of the situation that they're in. It is you alone that will handle that. If they will simply confess. We all know that we're sinners and we fall short. But we also believe in who Jesus is and what He has done for us. That He was born of a virgin, that He lived a sinless life, and that He died on a cross to pay for my sins because He didn't have to pay for any of His own. He had the ability to pay for mine. The greatest gift ever given. But it didn't end there because even in death, the power of God was revealed through the resurrection, and He is alive, and He's preparing a place for those who will follow Him and receive that gift. Lord, right now, help those who have not to make a decision to receive that gift this day and begin a new life of freedom. And Lord, for those of us who already know You, help us to embrace the provisions that You have given and hold firm to them and not allow any man to sway us. Do not allow the tempter to convince us that God just didn't, that God, You just didn't have it quite right when You told us the way it was. But things have changed. Nothing has changed. There's nothing new under the sun. This is Your creation, Lord, and You were right in everything that You said. So help us hold to the preciousness of life and liberty, to the right of property and appropriate judgment. Let us live it out in a way for others to see. Give us strength and power and courage to act now. We ask it in Jesus' name and by His power alone. Amen. This is a time of invitation, a time for you to decide. This is your decision time. You have the choice. No one else can choose for you. What will you do with what you have heard this day? Your choice and yours alone. You're invited to make a choice and a decision now and respond to what God has said to you in this time of invitation. I will be here. A couple of our deacons will be up front. If you'd like to come and pray with one of them, the altar will be open. You can come and pray. You can come and talk with one of us. We would love to help you out with anything we can. If you're looking for a church home, we would love to get to know you better and you to get to know us better and answer any questions you have. This may be where God wants you to be. We want to encourage you to be exactly where God wants you to be. And pursue that with all diligence. Let us help you with that, whatever the situation. But now is the time for you to respond to Him. As you stand, we're going to sing a hymn of invitation. You step out and come. And let's respond to God and see what He has in store for us.
Have you failed in your plan of your storm-tossed life? Place your hand in the nail's garden. Are you weary and worn from its toil and strife? Place your hand in the nail's garden. Place your hand in the nail's garden. Place your hand in the nail's garden.
Christ will comfort your heart. Put your trust in him. Place your hand in the nail's garden. Place your hand in the nail's garden. Place your hand in the nail's garden. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail's garden. Would you follow the will of the risen Lord? Place your hand in the nail's garden. Would you live in the light of his blessed word? Place your hand in the nail's garden. Place your hand in the nail's garden. Place your hand in the nail's garden. He will keep to the end. He's your dear. Is your soul burdened down with its load of sin? Place your hand in the nail's garden. Throw your heart open wide. Let the Savior in. Place your hand in the nail's garden. Place your hand in nail's garden. Place your hand in the nail's garden. He will keep to the end. He's your dearest friend. Place your hand in the nail's garden. The Savior to enter your heart. Why don't you let him come in? There's nothing in this world to keep you apart. What is your answer to me?
Got a few announcements this morning. If you are a veteran, we are wanting to do a special recognition for you. So we need photos of you in uniform, along with the branch that you served in, dates. So if you can, please turn those as soon as possible. Also, if you want to send them in on just like through email, you can send that to donnai62@roadrunner.com. Also, the GAs are collecting kids' gloves that will be given to schools. So please bring your items by October 26th and place them in boxes located by the office, fellowship hall, and sanctuary. Also, 1 week to go. We are 1 week till October 23rd. We're collecting everything we need except we have everything we need except postage to cover the cost of shipping boxes. For Operation Christmas Child, we need $7 per box, and we have about 210 boxes, so that's really nice. If we can cover the entire amount, we'll be able to track our boxes and see exactly where they end up. Also, FYI, please pick up a copy of the proposed 2017 budget. We have them located in the back, right when you walk in here. They're also by the office as well. But there is going to be a business meeting this Wednesday, and we're going to be voting on the proposed budget for that. Also, this announcement is not on your flyer. There is no church bonfire tonight. I was told that some people thought that there might be, and that was on the schedule, but we have decided that we are not going to do that. So just to be keeping in mind, we are not doing that tonight. So that's it.
All right, so we will be worshiping in Fellowship Hall tonight. Let me introduce somebody to you. Randy, come on up here for a minute. This is Randy Covey. Randy comes this morning rededicating his life to Jesus. He knows him as Lord and Savior, but is trying to get his life straightened out, and he needs some help. He needs your prayers, and he needs some victory in his life, and so we're getting him hooked up, and we're going to get him going in the right direction, but he needs your prayers. Your prayers will be the determination of his success in his walk with Christ, all right? So please remember Randy in your prayers as he desires to follow Jesus fully and completely, all right? You want to come by and encourage him, you can do that before you leave. We'd encourage you to do that, and I'll have Mike stand with him, and you can do that if you want to. Worship 6 o'clock in the chapel this evening, don't forget, and business meeting Wednesday night is, has been announced. We're going to close in a word of prayer, and then we'll sing a song as we go out.
So much can be done through you, Lord. And prayer is the winning shot, Lord. I pray that you'll be with him and help him in all of his issues or whatever he needs, Lord, and that you'll work in his heart and he'll give his life to you and stay with you, Lord, for eternity, Lord. I pray that you'll be with us this week and help us to be your hands and your mouth and your eyes and help us to do your will, Lord. It's in Jesus' name that we pray.
We got word this morning, Joyce Solomon passed away this morning. She was a long-time member of our church and active here. And so would encourage you, please keep the Solomon family in your prayers and watch for announcements. The service will be probably coming up this week. And so we'll want to be an encouragement and a support to the family in that time as well. Mike, lead us in a song as we...
Shout to the Lord of the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
I love you. Have a great week.